Not only ugly, it smells bad. Ugh, jeez.
We're sick.
Oh, nauseated. Oh.
We've been watching bad horror movies.
The worst.
Movies that reek.
Despised horror movies.
Movies people tell jokes about.
That make you bleed from the eyeballs.
Movies that have no right to exist.
They should be outlawed.
That make you puke.
Movies that you watch and you don't want to tell your friends about.
Ugh. But
oh God,
there's still some tasty, tasty films.
Piece of corn.
Do not go in there. Woo!
Hello, Internet.
What up?
I feel better. How about you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I took a lie down.
Yeah. If you're new to this whole thing, I'm Dr. Paul.
And I'm sorry you're here.
Don't say that you're more sorry than I am, because I'm capable of being just as sorry as you are. So we're both sorry, all right?
I'm Diet Dr. Paul.
And we are father, son, boomer, millennial. We're here to talk about movies the same way you talk about movies with your family, your friends, your mom, your dad, whatever. Our ultimate goal is to tip you off to something that maybe you never even heard of, maybe you know of, but you thought, I ain't gonna watch this. And that's especially true for today. What's our topic?
Topic is bad horror movies that you should watch.
Why should they watch them? Because we talk about movies that are so bad they're good.
Well, I think that there's sort of an overarching thing that can be here. That's part of it. That's sort of like one subgenre of bad horror movies. I think that there are horror movies that are like, for whatever reasons, audiences despise them, or maybe critics despise them, that you still find value in, or I find value in. So it can be all sorts of things.
You know, horror movies in general sometimes are not appreciated. Even really, really good horror films are, I mean, it's as a genre, I think some people just, I don't like. I was watching last night an interview with Victoria Price, which I think is it's Vincent Price's daughter. And, you know, she said, I'm not a fan of horror movies.
I am untethered and my rage knows no bounds.
I'm a fan of horror movie fans. She likes that, but she just doesn't, you know, just for some people, it just doesn't resonate with. I'm surprised at the movies that I... On my seven, and by the way, the whole thing, we call the sevens, and he's going to give seven choices. I'm going to give you my, I have no idea what he's going to say, and he has no idea what I'm going to say. Sometimes we overlap a little bit, mostly not, because he has a different perspective. He's younger, I'm older, kind of deal. We'll see. So in the end, though, some of the movies that I, on my list, I went and checked what, like Rotten Tomato scores. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding, kind of thing. So you want to start us off with your number seven?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Well, I had a couple honorable mentions
that
I wanted to throw out. Before, though, you should like and subscribe. Do that. Take a moment and do that. And then I'll pull my book out.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
A couple of... honorable mentions for me, Phantoms. I was going to put Phantoms on this list. I took it off because it was on another list that we did, but I said that's something that people should watch, the Rotten Tomatoes scores on that are really bad. There's a movie called Howl. I like werewolf movies, so finding good werewolf
movies. Not movie, Howling.
No, it's just called Howl. It's a werewolf movie about a London train that gets like stopped in the middle of nowhere. It's really good.
Which, by the way, our last episode was Wonderfest. Mm-hmm. And since we did that, Joe Dante has been on there. And I mentioned to you Joe Dante. So while I'm looking at him, I don't think you were thinking right. That's the director. He's the one that did Gremlins. He directed The Howling.
I know the name sounded familiar.
Yeah. He does a lot. I mean, he really has his own sort of unique perspective. I guess he and Spielberg were connected in some way. Mm-hmm. But so speaking of The Howling, excuse us while we digest.
While we digest.
Yes.
And then one more. There's a film, and I like Ty West a lot. There's a film called Innkeepers. They got 42% audience score on Rotten Tomatoes. And that's like his first big movie. And it's really a good movie too. So those are just three honorable mentions.
Of all your movies, which one had the lowest, don't tell me the name of it, but what was the lowest Rotten Tomatoes score you found?
Let's see here. The lowest that I have was a critic's score and it was 16%.
Huh, okay. Well, my number seven was 14%.
My number seven is from 2000 and it's a movie that I forget about all the time, even though it's stacked with A-list names, and that's 2000's What Lies Beneath. Kind of a thriller, kind of a horror movie. There's some really cool stuff with like how they shot that film, where it's got some Citizen Kane style elite cinematography.
I remember the director's commentary, and they mm-hmm. had special making, and they're talking about the filming, the camera tracking, and how
on
they
the
did
burnt
that.
Bridge scene. Yeah,
uh-huh.
But it's Robert Zemeckis, Harrison Ford, Michelle Pfeiffer. It's a ghost story. It's the neighbor. The new neighbor moves in. The wife is like watching him through the windows type deal. But I think it's a really solid movie. And it's 47% and 58% on Rotten Tomatoes, critics and audience, which is just, I don't get that. I think it's...
What is wrong with you?
I think it's a solid movie.
And it was 2000.
Yeah, that's a good movie.
It must have been in black and white with subtitles.
Last time I checked, no, but...
Because we joke around all the time. If it's in black and white, it has subtitles, you know, yeah. I mean, which you gotta, dude. I am shocked. I'm like, that is a really good movie. Excuse me, I'm not.
He's trying to steal. That would be one of the ones that I would have expected that is a possible crossover, but I don't know.
That I'm absolutely shocked, because I think I would have started that's a great mm-hmm. horror movie. I mean, it's not great.
It's not an elite horror movie, but it's a very good movie.
It is. It really is compelling. The story is compelling. It's got talk about the cast, Zemeckis. Mm-hmm. I mean,
Harrison Ford, Michelle mm-hmm. Pfeiffer, especially in 2000.
Oh, yeah.
That's like
hot.
Peak.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Wow. Okay. Take notes on this, okay? You really need to write that down, because that's something that you need to go back. It's relatively easy to get. And mine is, I'm going to not tell you, I want you to guess, okay, my film. All right? Well, use your thing. Need a clue?
Sure, give me a clue.
All right.
Evil Dead.
All right, think about this, okay? Small town, coastal town, right? And it is summer, all right? Tourist season's coming in, and body torn up, found on the beach.
Us?
They don't know what they're going to do, so they bring in an expert to sort of analyze, find out what the problem is. They want to close the beaches, right? Townsfolk, the mayor, but no, because they need the tourist dollars. So they hire this crazy guy who's going to come in and say, I'm going to take care of all of this thing, right?
Black. Or, I don't know.
What do you think? Yes.
I just said Jaws like 1,000 times.
No. Sand sharks.
Never heard of it.
Sand sharks, baby.
Never heard of it.
Sand sharks.
Never heard of it.
Oh, it is essentially, it's Jaws. But think about this. You know, it's the whole, the advertising line in Jaws, you know, is like, you know, going into the water. And really was. It was terrifying. People, mm-hmm. when Jaws came out and it was in the theater, people were afraid to go near the water, afraid to go. And it's like.
It's a good movie.
And I'm going to think about like how close into the shore will sharks come? And like it's 18 inches or 12 inches. That I remember that. I remember they used to do dive-in movies where people, you'd be in an inner tube watching the movie on a big inflatable screen kind of stuff at a pool. I mean, it's like.
You know how they should really do that to up the ante? Do that at night at the ocean at the beach and set one up. But you do the screen on the land, so you got to swim out and get in your little tube to even watch it.
Well,
terrifying.
I agree.
Someone's going to die.
I agree with you. And to be safe, though, if you're on the beach, right? Not if the sharks can go through the sand, okay?
Is this an actual movie?
Yes, it's an actual movie.
And the title of the movie is?
Sand Sharks.
And when did it come out?
It was a 2011 at a theater near you. I mean, there's an earthquake and it's a prehistoric, shark kind of thing.
No blip on my radar.
You have not been drinking deep of the full immense power of cinema.
Somebody's been drinking.
Just pull up the trailer, okay? The first of all, it is this is best a movie best consumed in a group with your friends, perhaps with your favorite beverage.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But it really is kind of this, and it's kind of amazing, kind of special effects. There's no cast and anything like that, but it really is. If you've seen Jaws, you'll be just drawing the connections constantly. It's just kind of amazing just to see the sharks sort of, you're just sitting on the beach kind of thing. You're done. You're gone. You know the scene in Jaws with the kid that's out there on the raft? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like that, except it's in the thing.
I love that scene.
Yeah. So, yeah, it is. It's bad, but it's charming.
I was knobbing it.
You were?
I was knobbing it.
Yeah. This was, it's actually voted one of the 10 most ridiculous shark movies by Virgin Media. So you heard it here first, folks.
I've never even heard of it. I'd be interested to go look at the trailer and see what it's all about.
You guys you're watching scenes from the trailer right now as we speak, because that's kind of his, that's what he does. I mean, I have the easy part in all of this. All I got to do is just show up and look like the supermodel that I am, mm-hmm. and try not to embarrass myself saying stupid things, which I've already figured out 3 stupid things I said in our last episode that's embarrassing.
It happens.
I know it is. We need to do a blooper. It's not even a blooper. It's just a stupid kind of...
Stupid reel.
Yeah. So anyway, all right.
Number 6. All right. Now, I already know that you probably don't like this movie if you've even seen it, but I'm a big fan of this one. It is called The Last Exorcism from 2010. No? Yes?
Who's in it?
The only really recognizable character in it is Caleb Landry Jones, and he is the brother of the girl in Get Out. You remember that? Mm-hmm. The redheaded kid. He's also in an X-Men movie. I really like him as an actor, but he's the biggest actor in that, and that's when he's probably a teenager. But it is a found footage style movie. But I like it because it's about I guess he was a kid pastor grown up, and he's kind of like, he doesn't really believe, but he's still doing it. But it's like, he's got this documentary film crew going around with him, showing him, how he does it. But he's just talking behind the scenes like, yeah, I mean, I really don't believe it anymore. And so he's going to go to do this exorcism that someone wants him to go to. And they do a fake exorcism where he's like, well, I do a service. They're not real, but some people need the mental, like, to snap out of it, to feel like mentally it's gone, if that's what they thought was sort of possessing them. So that's what he goes to do. He does it, and then, oops, it didn't work. And then the movie kind of does its thing. So
What was the year?
2010. It's very reminiscent to me of Emily mm-hmm. or The Exorcism of Emily Rose. It'd be like a found footage version of that.
Yeah, back then, the thing that you say about it, I mean, I'm not a big fan of the found footage. I think it's overdone, but that's in a time period I probably was seeing all those movies. Yeah, I don't remember.
It's a found footage movie, but it's not so much like the shaky camera, because they're shooting it like it's a documentary. So it's still much easier to watch. It's the critic score was 72%, which is good, but the audience gave it a 35%. Which is pretty bad.
And you like that.
And I liked it. I thought it was good. It was also a scary movie, too. Because remember on the DVD, they supposedly had, like, all of these, like, real recordings of exorcisms that you could listen to. And they'd spook you out by, like, read this out loud so that you don't... Because you can get possessed watching this. I'm like, I'm not watching this. Turning that crap right off. But it made you, get you scared. And so, cool little ploy there. Mm.
I'm sure I've heard of it. If I saw the poster, I probably would.
There's a sequel that they did a few years later, but I don't care much about it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. My number six, Anaconda. Now, I know, first of all, it's got like a 41% on Rotten Tomatoes. You got Ice Cube, and you got John Voight that's part of this, and Owen Williams, Eric Stoltz,
baby.
It is, I remember when Jennifer Lopez. Saw it. Really? I don't remember her being in it.
Yeah, she's the main female.
Yeah. My recollection when we first saw it is that this was when CGI was sort of first kind of like feeling its roots kind of stuff. And it's, you know, in the abyss, the creature that would go through the ship that was made of water kind of stuff. You can sort of see how CGI was sort of doing that and learning how to do it. It's so much better now. But it was amazing to watch. And it was, you know, the crew that's there in the jungle kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. It has its charm. I'm kind of surprised it was just a 41%.
That is really low.
Yeah, it is. It is by no means, it's not high art, but it deserves better than a 41. And it's certainly one of these. About everything that I had on my list is like, these are good movies to watch with, you know, friends, get together, you want to put something on. Yeah. It's not a bad movie to watch with kids.
No, it's not.
You know, I remember there's a scene where he eats somebody and then kind of like regurgitates them. And that
John
was
probably, Voight at the, yeah.
Yeah, that was the most.
And I think he blinks or something after that or something weird.
Yeah, it's kind of like Moby Dick, you know, Call Me Ahab kind of thing.
But really, it's Moby Dick on the Nile,
yeah.
Or in the Amazon.
Yeah, so, but it's, yeah. Bad, but good.
I have the VHS that we recorded as kids, where we'd, you know, get movies and we'd record the movies. And it's one of my prized ones because it's got Congo on it as well. And that movie's very similar to me. It's like kind of a little weirdly done. But I'm a big fan of Anaconda. Big fan of Anaconda. Is that it?
Yep.
You're done?
Well, I do.
Just stop trying to look at my paper. All right. Number five. Now, this is a movie that was a little bit of a head-scratcher because it looked like it was going to be really good, and then it got really bad reviews, and so I never saw it. It's called Antebellum from 2010.
You remember we saw the preview, the trailer in the theater. And thought,
yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, the guys have not directed anything since. I thought it was produced by Jordan Peele, but I don't think it was. But it's 31% critic score, 50% audience score. And I saw it, and I was kind of like baffled when I finally did see it, which is probably like 10 years after, well, maybe not that long. When did I say it came out? 2020. So, yeah, I probably saw it a year ago, maybe. And I thought it was a good movie.
I remember you telling me about it. Have you seen it? I said, no. I said, it's really...
Super interesting premise on horror. It is a horror movie, I would say, for sure, about slavery. And this woman as a slave. I don't want to say a whole lot about the plot because I don't want to give it away. It's very reminiscent of like an M. Night Shyamalan movie, though. But I thought it was well done. I thought it had a good little twists in there. I thought it was well acted. Janelle Monáe's great. There's a young Spanish man who in it who's really, really good. I really like him. He was in, what's the name, that Hustle movie? I can't remember the name.
American Hustle,
yes. He played, I think, a senator or something in it. But... It's a good movie.
Hmm. You know, I think sometimes, like, we saw the trailer for that and thought, oh my goodness, that looks really good. Mm-hmm. And then it comes out, and I think sometimes, I don't know if it's is it hard for people to disagree and say, I like this, even though people hated it kind of mm-hmm. stuff. For example, we just talked about Argyle a couple of episodes back, and I think we might have been talking about movies that we're looking forward to. Just came out this week, panned. Kind of stuff, and it is being panned.
Well, by the critics, it is. The audiences like it.
Well, I don't. What I saw was low on both, but you might.
Well, know. I looked yesterday,
yeah,
and it was like I remember it being like a 35 yeah. critics, but it was like a 72 audience or something like that.
Yeah, I don't know. Sometimes if as are the Rotten Tomatoes, but I think we should do a show sometime on Rotten Tomatoes and sort of unpack the how that happens, the good, the bad, and the ugly, how it's connected.
I think it can sway.
I do. And I think the veracity sometimes, the honesty of what they're getting and how people are using it and misusing it. Mm-hmm. I like the old days where films had a chance to find their audience. And I'm saying that there's not bad movies out there, but I'm kind of surprised. The trailer looked really good, and I think the studio thought that they had a winning product. It certainly got a winning cast. Same thing with Antebellum. I'm just kind of surprised. And you said you liked it, but yeah.
When it's one of those movies where you see it and you're like, I don't get what people mm-hmm. hated about it, at least not mm-hmm. to that extent.
So look into the camera and tell people, go see Antebellum.
Go see Antebellum.
You heard it there. Okay, what else do you need to hear? Irrefutable. What else do you need to hear? Okay, is it black and white?
No.
But there's a lot of black people in it.
Whoa, yeah, the black and white in that sense.
Okay.
Yes.
Right.
Some brown.
Subtitles?
If you want.
Okay. Is there any haunted dolls?
Unless there's a person named Doll that gets haunted.
Because that's, you have to have either a haunted nun or a haunted priest or a haunted doll.
I don't think that any seems of that's to be all the thing. Yeah. Maybe I should add that to one of my three tenets of horror films.
Yeah. All right. My number five. Is that where we're at? Leprechaun in the Hood.
I skipped saw that on a bunch of lists.
You know, it's 33% on RT. We both love Warwick Davis. He's kind of near and dear in our heart. And didn't we go to mm-hmm. somewhere and you got us?
We were at Disney World and it was like Star Wars. There was like Star Wars theme because it was when they were redoing, maybe it was the prequels, or there was when they were redoing the originals again. They were like re-editing them, the special effects. And right when we got there, we like looked and see, oh look, Boba Fett is signing autographs. But they were no longer accepting people in the line because he was about done. But we walked there and we're like, but if you wait 20 minutes, you'll be first in line for Wicket, which was as the Ewok. And so we waited.
Do you still have that?
Yes, I do.
Where's it at?
Right alongside of my signed picture from Out for Justice.
Anybody seen Richie?
Yep.
You know, I think if you look at the entire Warwick, that entire franchise, they're all pretty much despised. Mm-hmm. I think the highest rated one was Back to the Hood kind of stuff. And I see the Leprechaun in the Hood was an attempt to sort of revitalize
When did it come out?
I don't know that I put the dates down in mine. I didn't for that one.
I'm just curious.
Yeah. I think it's one of those things. Here's an example. I saw it once, and you know how normally that's my rule. If I like it, I see it again. But I think it was really not that I have avoided it. It's just never been in a position where you don't see it. And Halloween, and when they're throwing, and AMC classics and all this kind of stuff, you don't see any of the Leprechaun film. Mm-hmm. When people talk about the best genre franchise, horror franchises, we're getting ready to film another episode of Film Fight Club where we're going to compete on what I think is the best horror franchise against yours. You probably picked Leprechaun, didn't you?
No.
I bet you did.
Didn't.
Well, you stick around.
I can honestly say it's one of the few like big franchises where I've not seen a lot of them.
Yeah. It is, I kind of think it's one of those things that, like in Valentine's Day, you watch, now we have a Thanksgiving horror movie to watch, and Christmas mm-hmm. is all okay. This gives you something on St. Patrick's Day to be able to watch Leprechaun in the Hood. I think watch them all. Give it a chance. I really think that franchise, and especially Warwick Davis is just, he's good.
I love Warwick
Davis.
He's got
good, yeah.
I'm a big fan of his.
Yeah.
I don't remember a lot about that one. That's one of the ones that I've seen. I think my favorite is just the first one. I think that there's some charm to it. Jennifer Aniston, it's got the kid in it. It's very cliche. It's got the fat guy in it from Teen Wolf and Pee Wee Herman. But it's good. And again, it's a lot of Warwick Davis and then just cliche, cheesy 80s horror movie. But well, I think it works.
You're building a horror movie around a holiday. Yeah, with Friday the 13th and that kind of stuff.
But I don't know that... I mean, I get it that it's about a leprechaun, but I never thought the movies were centered around the idea of St. Patrick's Day at all, though.
Well, that's the day when, that's a big, that is, I mean, how many holidays do leprechauns get?
But do they even celebrate St. Patrick's Day in Ireland?
I know so little about Irish history.
Okay. Potato. Potato, potato. I don't get it.
Me either.
I have potatoes in Ireland. All right. Is that all? Is that all you had to say?
That's all I have to say about Leprechaun in the Hood.
Okay. All right. This is a good one. This is the one that's the lowest rated that I told you. It's 16% critic, 58% audience, and that's 1999's Idle Hands.
Really?
Mm-hmm. It did not get good reviews. And now, maybe granted, in that time that people were looking at it like it was supposed to be a little more serious than it did, it's totally schlocky, shticky, it's campy, it's funny, it's not really scary, it's gory, it's over the top. It's Devin Sawa and Jessica Alba and Seth Green and, you know, the killer. They're looking for the killer. I'm not going to spoil it if you've not seen it. But it's a good 90s horror movie. It's funny again. And then you got your little teen heartthrob in there, Devin Sawa. Well-made movie, good ending, nice special effects. What more could you ask for?
I am shocked. For me, it's a better film than Basket Case. And I think, and maybe we're seeing it through the eyes of the, we used to do horror marathons when you were little, and that was one of the films that we would show, these 24-hour parties that we would do with you and your friends and your sister and her friends. And that was one that I remember. Of course, everybody was all crazy that teen, you know, period. And I thought it was kind of, I'm shocked it's so low rated.
Yeah, I mean, I like the friends that come back after they die, that whole deal. It's funny. It's good.
I'm betting that you have a soft spot in your heart for Idle Hands. And that sounded weird. I just think that's probably a movie.
I bet Idle Hands tickle your fancy.
I Know What You Did Last Summer and Scream and all those and the ones where the Final Destination, all that. I put all of those in that kind of time period, those teen, young, supermodel kind of kid. I think they were delightful.
I Know What
shocked.
You Did Last Summer?
Yeah.
41 and 45% on Rotten Tomatoes.
I still Know What You Did Last Summer, which was on my list, but it got booted off, the same thing. And I thought
Yeah, I'm so surprised that first movie is rated so low. I thought it was right up there with Scream.
I think the more recent Scream, the last couple of them, I think are worse than Idle Hands. Worse than...
You think so?
I do. Mm. I do. That whole franchise Scream just went off, jumped the shark for me. I have no need for it anymore. Mm. But I would watch Idle Hands again. What are you laughing at?
Nothing.
Why? What's so funny?
You're just a funny guy.
How am I funny? How exactly am I funny? Like, how do I, I'm a comedian?
Mm-hmm. He thinks he's funny.
Doggy. Well, let me tell you, my number four, Billy the Kid versus Dracula.
Never heard of it.
Oh, contraire, ma frère.
Probably not a real movie.
Oh, it is. 18%. It was on a double bill with Jesse James versus Frankenstein's Daughter. Right? this is the better of them. I saw this. Where do you think
not
I saw this?
Not a high
this?
Bar.
Where do you think I saw this at?
The Southern Theater.
Southern Theater, Columbus, Ohio. It was a grindhouse back in the 60s, and it was delightful for looking through my little 9-year-old or 10-year-old. I didn't really have very good parents. They just sort of let me go to the movie all day long, every day.
Tie a dollar around his neck.
I had great, great, great childhood, great parents kind of stuff. You did too. Billy the Kid versus Dracula. It was Carradine's. So many of those guys. John Carradine. Now, John Carradine thinks that this is his worst film that he ever made. It is a nice movie to watch from the standpoint of picking out all of the mistakes that happen in it. I don't know if you are a fan of the horror soap opera, Dark Shadows.
I mean, I get what it is. I'm a big fan.
There are people that what they do is simply watch that to see, like, when the set will shake, when a door closes, or that kind of just crazy stuff, because it's live, so you can't stop it. You know, mm-hmm. you got to keep going. And so there's online, you find all kinds of things that you can say on this episode, what craziness happened. This was a film, but the craziness persisted and bad things like people, you will walk, you'll see people, you know, through a window that shouldn't be seen kind of stuff. And it's directed by William Bodine, who is, you probably never heard of him.
Did you say the year on this one?
No, it was 60 something kind of deal.
Old.
He is minimally, he directed about 350 films in his career, but there are some lists that have him over 500, 550 films that he directed. He was churning them out. He directed both this and Jesse James versus Frankenstein's Daughter. It was a great double bill. And so it is one of this mashup between horror and westerns, which is kind of nice that you see there's a
could have been a good use for the term spaghetti western.
Yeah. Why?
Spaghetti for the blood. Get it? Spaghetti westerns. Spaghetti western. He doesn't get it.
I get it.
He didn't.
I get it. So I just think it is a delightful movie. It's actually, I'm going to peel back the curtain here and tell you, it was number 7, but I didn't do that. I put Sharks on it, which is a better film. I did Sharks first because I think sometimes there are people that start watching this and they're going to watch to see what our first couple of reviews are. And they're going to say, no. And there are younger people that are watching this. They're going to say, Billy the Kid versus Dracula. There's no way I'd be bleeding from my eyeballs. But Sand Sharks? Oh, that sounds modern. That's sort, you know, kind of
like
stuff.
Some sort of skin condition.
What?
Sand sharks?
Yeah.
I got a case
moderate or severe.
Sand Sharks.
Yeah. So this is really, this really was number 7, but I couldn't make it number 7 because I don't think folks would actually. I think
he didn't. Stick to his guns.
I did. Yeah. Double feature.
Never heard of either of those movies.
Well, let me just say this. If there are anybody out there that have lobby cards from either of these movies that you would, that they're looking for a good home, I have such a soft spot in my heart for that time period at the Southern Theater. I have a database that I've kept that has every movie that I've ever seen and that I can recall mm-hmm. in the Southern Theater. And this was right up there with Last Man on Earth. So
send them to me instead. What was that number?
That was number 4.
Number 3. And this consequently came on last night, so I had to watch some of it. And it is 2001's Jeepers Creepers.
That was really good movie.
45% and 49% on Rotten Tomatoes. Now, I know the director turned out to be kind of a schmuck and not a good guy. I've said that before, but I'm talking about just the movie here. Justin Long is great in it. I really, when I was watching it last night, I really was enamored. I was like, man, he really does. He's like a great actor in this and really sells the terror in some of these scenes. Because it's a little campy at times. But I think it's a super interesting concept. Even the second one.
I did not like the second one. That's where I thought, okay, just let it. That's
well, I didn't see it when it came out originally. I was like, this looks really dumb. But I actually saw that one probably this October for the first time. And I thought it wasn't too bad.
Yeah. I'm shocked. I mean, just about every movie that you've said on there, I'm kind of shocked. Because normally, a lot of the movies that you like, I can't, you know, can't stand by. But just about everything you said, yeah, those are good movies. I watched those again. I watched that again. Mm-hmm. I think I own that.
Yeah, I remember when we watched it the first time.
Shocking. Mm-hmm. Shocking. Do you think that some of the scores are backlash against the director?
No, well, I guess if there's a film that could potentially happen to, it would be this one, because I don't think Rotten Tomatoes was a thing back when this came out. So, potentially.
Hmm.
But I think it deserves some love for sure.
Wow. Mm-hmm. All right. Give it some love. Look in the camera, Tim. Say, give me some love.
Give it some love.
Yeah. Okay.
Not me.
All right. Well, you need some love, too.
Yeah, sure. Why not?
Yeah. All right. My number 3, Jason X. Yep. Jason X. It is... What are you laughing at?
It's such a bad movie.
No, it's not.
Mm-hmm.
No.
We saw that movie in the theater.
I know.
Yeah.
It was good.
No, it's not.
And
one of my favorite scenes, though, is when he beats the cheerleaders or the camp girls to death in the sleeping bag.
Yes.
That's one of my favorite parts.
Yes, the whole computer-generated, okay, put the tape on kind of stuff. David Cronenberg, okay, is, you know, does the cameo in the beginning. To me, I think it was only 19% on Rotten Tomatoes. I think that the franchise was sort of starting to get tired and sleepy. I think it happened
before that movie.
What?
Before Jason X, I think it already started kind of to happen.
Oh, yeah. But I think this was an attempt to sort of breathe some fresh life into it. Because you're taking it into space, you know, in the future and all this kind of stuff. And the special effects, you got to admit, were really good. You know, there's a scene where the woman goes into the liquid nitrogen kind of stuff. And then
he smashes
it. Yeah, and then he bashes somebody's face in kind of stuff.
Nanorobot things.
But the best scene was the one with the whole sleeping bag kind of stuff.
Yeah, that's hysterical.
In some ways, I mean, I don't know what you're going to pick when it's Film Fight Club, but I would have probably taken Friday 13th, that whole series, over Halloween or Nightmare on Elm Street, any of those kind of things. I think I had the box set till I think something happened to it. I don't remember what it was.
Mm-hmm.
But I do think in some ways, it's more watchable, and it's a little bit more of like the Final Destination for the kills are a little bit more creative than what Michael did or Freddy did kind of stuff.
Yeah, I think I agree with what you said there. I think it's better as a series than Friday the 13th or Nightmare on Elm Street or Halloween or the others. I think it's the best one.
Jason X, I think the next movie in that cycle was Freddy versus Jason, and that kind of fell flatter for me than this one does. And
really?
I really do think this is one of the better ones.
Yeah,
and it has some watchability to it. It makes me want to watch it right now.
When was the last
time
you watched it?
Do you have my DVD? Well, of course, we moved, and my entire video collection and music collection is still.
I'm just saying, when was the last time you think you saw it?
It's probably 10 years.
You should watch it again. It's pretty bad.
Really?
It's not good. I mean, I enjoy it because I like Jason a lot, so I watch it, but I don't think it's I almost put it on my list, but it's not because it was a good movie. It's one of those movies that gets so bad that it's good. The kills in it are cool. I'll give you that much.
I maybe we saw a different
movie. There's definitely some cheese in there, man.
All right.
All right, that was your number three.
Yeah.
My number two. And this one, I think, is the poster child for this sort of video right here. And it was the first one that I thought of. And that is 1982's Halloween 3, Season of the Witch. So it was an uphill battle for this movie to begin with. Why they had to name it that way and then it have nothing to do with Freddy or with Michael Myers at all. You were setting yourself up for failure. It's the same thing that kind of happened to Prometheus, the movie, is that people are waiting around for the alien to show up, but that's not what this movie's about. So I think that uphill battle in itself is going to hurt it, because what was the Rotten Tomatoes score? I don't know why I didn't say that. Yeah, it was a 50% critic score, 28% audience score. And I think it's one of the better Halloween films overall, outside maybe the first one. Super watchable. Scott Atkins and his little 1980s mustache. It's clever. It's eerie. It's got the whole Halloween masks in it are kind of iconic to me. I just don't
Scott
get it.
Scott Atkins is in that?
Mm-hmm. Remember, did I say that right?
Yeah. I didn't know that.
Did I say that correctly? Tom Atkins. Sorry. Not Scott Atkins. He's in John Wick. That's who you're talking about. Yeah, no, not him.
Sorry.
Tom Atkins. My bad, yo.
If he was here, he'd kick your butt.
He would. I'd be out the window.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I agree with you. And I did think it got a lot of negative buzz because of it was too different than, sometimes mm-hmm. when you have a formula like a franchise, the challenge is always, how do you give people enough of what they want, but not so much that they are, it's boring. And mm-hmm. how do you change it up a little bit? That's always the challenge in
you want to oversaturate yourself
and reinvent it. Mm-hmm. And which is why I thought Jason X was exactly that. It was, you still have the killer, you still have all the rules that goes with Jason, but you're taking it in a different mm-hmm. social context.
He's in space now.
I know that. I mean, not right now. He's not. Where is he right now?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, I'm actually kind of surprised at that. So,
boom.
All right. You're going to be shocked by this because I was shocked by this. And in some ways, this would be my number one.
Okay.
Right? John Carpenter's Vampires.
That was almost on my list.
Really?
It was almost on my list. It was one of the first, I think it was the first thing that I wrote down, actually. No, it was the second thing. I wrote Antebellum down first, and then John Carpenter's Vampires was the second.
47% on Rotten Tomatoes. It's just, mm-hmm. And I've watched this over and over and over again.
Watched it this week.
James Woods and Daniel Baldwin. Maximilian Schell. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love vampire and I love the whole mythos that goes with vampires, but it was new and it was modern and you got these, like a biker gang going out and doing it. And the scene in the hotel where they're there with all the hookers and the vampires show up, I'm really surprised. I don't understand what people didn't like about it. Mm-hmm. I understand mainstream critics not wanting to like it,
mm-hmm.
but people that have an affinity for the horror genre.
Yep.
I would think this was easily be. If we did an episode on the top vampire movies,
mm-hmm.
it's going to be in my top three.
I liken it a lot of the time to Dusk Till Dawn. I think it's in the same realm as that movie.
Don't you think that's much, much higher rated?
Oh, and it is, because I looked into Dusk Till Dawn after I looked at that, thinking like the same thing. Like, ooh, if this is rated low, then clearly Dusk Till Dawn will be rated low by other people. But no, it was highly rated.
What's the problem with vampires?
Maybe it has something to do with it being John Carpenter's vampires. Maybe that hurt it. I don't know.
You think that, I mean, John Carpenter...
His stock was not at his highest at that point.
Mm.
I'm not sure. I don't know.
I mean, Ghost to Mars is probably my least favorite movie that he did.
That was another one that I looked at for this list, and that's not a good movie at all.
Okay. All right. Vampires. It is a whopping good time. All right. There's nothing in there. It's like, trust me. I'm going to go back. If you watch Billy the Kid versus Dracula, it's going to have a hard time sort of, you know, especially younger people. Older people, you're going to be right there for it. Vampires, you're going to love it. Love it.
As long as they don't twilight, twinkle, sparkle. None of that.
No.
None of that.
No. Okay.
That was number two. So my number one. And I thought you were going to, I thought this one was going to be one that you liked, but you just dogged it not too long ago. And that's Freddy versus Jason. I think that at the same time, it may be the best Jason movie and the best Freddy movie simultaneously.
Stop the press.
Okay. Now, I know the director, Ronnie Yu, he's done a bunch of sequel movies that have, like, I think done pretty well, at least as cult favorites. I cannot remember what they were. I didn't write them down. But obviously, you got Robert Englund. You've got some tie-ins to some of the other Friday the 3rd, or some of the other Freddy movies. But I think it's just great. It's a perfect slasher film for me. Especially coming from the time period that it came from, because I saw that in high school, so it was like right up my alley.
I need to go back and revisit it. I really need to go back and purchase the entire, box set. And I'm much more of a fan of Jason than I am Freddy.
I think Freddy very similar to like Pinhead for me. Like the character's cool, but a lot of time the movies aren't so good. Maybe there's good parts to them or there's good scenes, but I think some of the films are just a little dry at times.
It's like Alien versus Predator for me. I love the Alien. Predator, I never thought much of Predator.
Not a big fan of the Predator either.
Yeah. And so when I said earlier that I thought that Jason X is superior, you kind of maybe threw up a little bit in the back of your throat.
Well, no, but I just was not expecting you to like Jason X and not like Freddy versus Jason.
Yeah.
He's on drugs. Copious amounts of drugs.
Sorry. Just dropped on the head as a baby.
Yeah.
You're going to be shocked at my number one. Okay? You will. And there's method to the madness. But my number one, Dead Alive.
How's that a bad movie?
Well, here's why, you know, first of all, and on it is 89% on Rotten Tomatoes. And it's brilliant. You know, you got the Peter Jackson going in there. It has a charm to it. The fact that it's New Zealand, and it's kind of like, that's one of the things that I liked about it, because it looked different. Frighteners, the same thing. It was filmed in New Zealand. Mm-hmm. It looks, you know, we get used to going to movies and we know what New York and we know what Los Angeles looks like, and to now more Baltimore and stuff like that. So to see New Zealand, it's like, mm-hmm. Oh my, just looks strange. It's unsettling. I liked it. The problem with Dead Alive is I think that there's folks out there that if you put that on, that 15 minutes into the movie, you're going to shut it off. It is kind of melodramatic. The music is cheesy.
I think it's part of the charm.
I know it is. And trust me, the payoff is huge on this movie. But the creature effects, the monkey, you know, and all that kind of stuff, you're going to watch it and you're going to think, this is a piece of crap. Because the monster effects, the practical effects on this, the puppet effects, what it is just, it does not hold up, but it does have a unique charm. And it is considered at that time was the goriest movie ever made. Mm-hmm. Peter Jackson, I mean, is just, you know, he's just a brilliant director. I saw it first in Cleveland at the 24-hour horror marathon there. And it was a movie that was like 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, you know, midnight kind of thing. And a lot of people were starting to fall asleep. It was magical to have 800 people sitting in a theater and they're all experiencing this movie. And it is hysterical and people are laughing out loud. And it is there's humor in it. The zombie baby, the priest, you know, I kick arse for the Lord. It is, but I'm afraid that you folks are never going to get to that point. You're never going to see, because you're going to start it and 15 minutes in it looks fake, it looks funky, and you're just going to say, I don't have the time for this. I'm going to go and put on a Haunted Nun movie. So that's the thing, is that it looks like one of the worst horror movies ever made, but you have to understand the time period and understand what they're trying to do with it. I mean, where else are you going to watch somebody eat a dog? Okay. Yeah. It's as shocking as the one that we just saw, When Evil Lurks, kind of stuff. But mm-hmm. When Evil Lurks has
realistic.
Yes, you're going to watch that. You're going to be riveted. You put Dead Alive on, or Brain Dead, as I think what it was originally called. You're going to think, no. So please give it a chance. It will be one of the best times you've ever had at a movie. And it works best in a crowd. Get your friends together, you know, cross-generational is good. Make a party out of that one.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Do you understand why I would? Don't you think a lot of people would turn
it
off?
I don't think it looked particularly realistic when it came out. I think it's always been kind of cheesy looking, even though it was, but it's so over the top that it lends itself, I think, to the way it looks now.
But there was nothing to compare it with. Mm-mm. In term when it first came out. And so, you know, people didn't, it wasn't unusual to see a movie that was fake with fake practical effects. You look at The Thing, and mm-hmm. Thing is a beloved movie, but the practical effects in that, you know, kind of like, oh.
They're amazing. What are you talking about?
Well, but it doesn't, it's not.
Put your foot in your mouth.
I've said it before and you've squared off with me on that kind of stuff. Yeah. I think there are a lot of people that look at it and they're going to just, no, that's because it looks fake to them and cartoony or stop action animation. And I don't want to have any place for that. Younger audiences have been raised with everything with digital effects. And you know, I remember growing up and you would have green screen effects and you could always see the outline of the character around mm-hmm. it. But that didn't detract. You know, I still watching it kind of stuff and think, okay, you know, this thing. And when you first start seeing movies and that's seamless mm-hmm. and blue screen, green screen, it's wonderful. Stop action, with Ray Harryhausen, you'd see it and think, and it never really looked all that real. Then Jurassic Park comes out and your jaws drop mm-hmm. kind of stuff. And you look at Jurassic Park now and how even aged that looks. So I think a lot of people look at The Thing, they look at Dead Alive, and it's like, that's not for me. You really need to. It's the same reason why I tell people, just because it has subtitles, don't shy away from it. Just because it's black and white, don't shy away from it. Some of my best viewing experiences have been movies that, at first look, you might want to pass on.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's all I got to say. I'm done with you. You too.
You sure?
You're on my list.
Yeah. Good luck.
You and Freddie and Jason.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And what was your number one again?
Freddie versus Jason.
Yeah.
You just said it.
It gets lost in the sea of most. I agree. Like six of the seven films that you just did. Man, I'm right there for it. So. All right. You got anything else you want to say to our friends out there? Yeah, like good. Us, subscribe us, tell your friends about it.
Do that too.
Yeah, that too. As normal, thank you for taking your time out. This is a show. We drop a new episode every single Thursday. We have not missed a Thursday since we started. We're a little into 7-8 months now of doing this. We hope you have as much fun watching and being a part of this as we have doing it. We love your ideas. We love your feedback. We read every single thing. And people have really been rather kind. And I appreciate that because mm-hmm. the internet is a cold, dark, scary place. Mm-hmm. And it's full of hate and vitriol. So we will see you at the movies.